Welcome to the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, your one-stop shop for all things West Indies cricket, by the fans, for the fans. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another episode, another edition of the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. I'm your host, one half of the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, Mashel St. Patrick Hewitt. And before everyone crucifies me and says, where is Santoki? Come on, you lot know how Santoki does. Every 10 seconds, he's not in the country. He's traveling the world somewhere. So when he does that, I've got to record these ones myself and keep it moving, you know, but first things first, just some quick admin out of the way. If you are a supporter or if you're new to the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, you can find us on all the usual channels, Twitter, Instagram, at Carib Cricket. If you're watching this on YouTube, obviously press like, share, subscribe, do all of that jazz. If you're listening to us on the audio platform of your choosing, please leave a review, rate the podcast. I forgot that all of that stuff matters, and I always forget to say all that, but do rate, leave a review if you can, certainly rate it if you can, and thank you to everyone who engages with our content. So what do we have for you today? Do you know what? I'm super glad to have this episode today, because I've been wanting to record something like this for at least 2 years. And I've reached out to people in the industry, no shade. I've reached out to people within the industry before and said, oh, do you mind coming on and talking about this? And I meant it purely in the sense of, I don't know. And I think a lot of fans of whatever particular cricket team or individuals you like in cricket, whatever, I think a lot of us just don't know. And it's about the industry, let's call it the sports management industry, let's call it the cricket agent industry, whatever you want to particularly call it. I've always wondered how it works, and I think it's quite pertinent in the West Indian context, because of course we see a lot of our players within the region play here, there and everywhere. They almost need to be a successful cricketer from the region, you need to play elsewhere. I think it's fair to say you can't just rely on the off chance that you may or may not play for the West Indies, and even then will you be a full format player, and so on and so forth. So I think more than anything in the kind of Caribbean cricket context, it's quite important to understand how cricket agency works and sports management's work, and why we might see a player go here and then go there, and so on and so forth. So I'm delighted to have on Eathan Brookes from Gravity Sports, who we've worked with them quite a bit over the last few months in terms of just a few advertised a few blog posts that they've done. If you follow us certainly on Instagram, you would have seen those. Some of their clients, we had Roshon Primus on in one of our more recent episodes. Go and watch that. Listen to that if you haven't done so. I'm sure we're going to get onto it, but probably their most important cricketer that's currently part of their client set is Alick, Athanze. If you're not talking about Alick, Athanze right now, then who are you talking about in the region? And obviously, Alick got his recent pick to tour South Africa, didn't get to play in any of the tests, but I would be shocked and surprised if he's not playing in the test series against India later this year. The sheer volume of runs demands that that's probably going to happen later on this year. But it's not just about Alick. There's a whole roster behind Gravity Sports, and we're looking to kind of talk about that and talk about cricket agency and so on and so forth. So without any further ado, let me bring on today's guest. Yes, Eathan, I hope I've given you the right amount of intro there. How you doing?
Yeah, what a builder. Thanks for that, Michelle.
Appreciate it. Much appreciated. And the thing is, Eathan, before I even press record, obviously we were talking backstage a bit about what this episode's gonna be about, and I think that the best place to start has to be just giving you, I'm going to just give you the forum for however long you need, just to explain who Gravity Sports are, what you do, et cetera, et cetera. Because the one thing that's certainly going to happen after this episode is everybody's going to flock towards your socials, your handles, and all of that. So now's your time to, right at the top of the show, talk about Gravity Sports.
Yeah, no, thank you for the introduction. And it's a shame we've not got Santoki with us, but I'm sure he'll be watching from afar. So yeah, no, as you've introduced us, really, we are a cricket agency based globally. So we don't really work specifically in just the Caribbean, but a lot of our guys are in the Caribbean. We represent players, so we will help them with contract negotiations, PR and marketing, which is a big part of what we do through our social media, making sure they've got sufficient profiles on the websites, pushing their name in front of potential teams and clients, which is a challenge in itself. I'm sure we'll come on to at some point. But yeah, no, that's essentially what we do. And also just there to lend an ear to players really as well. If they need perhaps some legal support, we can push them in a certain direction to a solicitor or a lawyer if they need one. Any financial support, again, we can push them in the right direction on that. So I think there's a lot of, as we'll come on to, I think there's a lot of players out there who perhaps aren't being represented as well as they should be. And we've sort of started the business really to make sure that players are getting the right representation and also getting value for their money when they're paying the fees to agents.
Yeah, most definitely. And I'm glad you've kind of touched on, because I think, would it be fair to say that certainly from a fan perspective, when we think cricket agent, and maybe this is because of kind of the kind of global conglomerate that the football industry is. So when we think cricket agent, we're thinking big money transfers, agent getting a massive cut. But we think of agent in the context of transfers, and we probably don't really think deep enough in the context of all the things behind the scenes before you even talking about where a player might be going and so on and so forth. And if you just kind of delve you've kind of done it, but how much of, if you had to skewer it, if it's possible in terms of percentages, how much of it is getting a player a deal versus managing a player's career? And by that, I mean, the thing's nothing to do with like, you're going to play with this club now, or you're going to do this, or you're going to go to that club or this league or whatever it might be.
Yeah, I think it depends on the agency as well, really, and what type of player, because different players require different types of management at different points of their career. Someone who is perhaps new to the scene and maybe hasn't got the name that they've an ex-international player or current international player, there might be a lot more work that goes into PR and advertising. But if you've got, say, a guy who everyone already knows who they are, there'll be a lot more hands-on work with speaking to clubs, making sure that they've got moves lined up and actually their calendar's full for a lot of the year. So I think as soon as some of our players start to go on that journey, we'll start to see a little bit more of that. From our perspective at the moment, we do a lot more PR and advertising for our guys, and you'll have seen that through our social medias with Alick. Every time he scores 100 or breathes or as a drink, anything, we make sure it's on social media and advertising on that front. But I think, you touched on it as well with the world of football and cricket agents. And I think people see agents as George Mendes or, the sort of super agents. And I can tell you now, cricket's just not like that. It's not like that at the moment. Unfortunately, I'm not doing this from my swimming pool in Barbados or somewhere. So, I think there are guys that do well out of the industry for sure. I think, you look at someone like Sam Curran, who drafted for $2.25 million or whatever it was. I'm sure his agent's done quite a lot of that. And there'll be guys that play regularly that do well. I think for us as a newer business, we've been going just over a year. Things are building slowly, but, they're going in the right direction.
Yeah. And as you say there, like a new business and starting within the year. So, and that almost... Say I wanted to be an agent tomorrow. let's say I wanted to go down that route. And I guess looking at the context of it in gravity sports, how do you go? I know you're going to say to me, there's no one way to do it, right? Maybe like an ex-player could effectively just become an agent through the sheer number of contacts they have, right? But for the lay person like me, say I jacked my job in tomorrow and I said, you know what, through this Caribbean Cricket Podcast, I know I know every single player in the Caribbean. I'm going to be an agent. How does someone, from your perspective, break into the industry, particularly when there's already so many people kind of with their tentacles in it?
A lot of hard work. With not trying to sound vague on that, but honestly, a lot of hard work, and just trying to make sure that you're aware of the opportunities that kind of happen in the industry. I think we entered the industry off the back of looking after a player who came and played for my club in the UK a few years ago. And we looked after him really well, and for us, we had that conversation around players not being represented properly, which is why we decided to go down that route. So I think to be honest with you, I think if you're aware of the opportunities, like I said, and you can keep a handle on the industry. For us, we came in with certain preconceptions around where we thought the industry was, and actually, as we've gone further down the line over the last year or so, our priorities and the way that we work have changed for sure. But it's not easy, and you just got to keep plugging away, I think.
Yeah, and again, listeners will be like, so who do Gravity Sports have on their books? And people, I will just say again, whether you're watching on YouTube or listening on the audios, all the links to where you can find out about Gravity Sports will be in the descriptors below, so you can go and click on all of those things. But when people do click on those things, or those links, I should say, Ethan, they'll see Roshon Primus, they'll see Alick Athanze, they'll see Kofi James, Keacy Carty, as a recent addition as well. And what's really interesting to me is whatever your links are within the region, you're doing really well. Because if I was going to find some players and suggest to an agent, yeah, you want to pick some Caribbean players who I think have great upside, those four probably would have been in my top 10 for sure. So whatever your branches are out in the Caribbean, you're certainly doing the right thing. And if we take, and it's not about just picking Alick, because, I mean, Keacy Carty in the West Indies ODI side, he's trying to establish himself. I think Kofi James certainly has a massive upside in the near future. Roshon, obviously, we all saw what he did in Super 50 last year when he was on the pod a few months back. He was out in Australia at the time. He's come back subsequently and played for Barbados Pride in the West Indies Championships. They're all doing their bits and pieces. But if we take Alick, because Alick is the man of the moment at this precise moment in time, and I don't know how much you can say, so obviously speak within the context of what you can. But Alick's journey, for example, when did the agency know this is the guy? This is the one. And the reason why I ask Ethan is because, and I think I've tweeted about this in the past, last year, May 2022, Wisden were doing an article on the best players under the age of 25 in the Caribbean. And Joe Harmon from Wisden sent me an email and said, "Mash, out of interest, who would you say is one of the best players under the age of 25 that everyone in world cricket should look out for?" And I said, if it was me, it'll be Alick Athanze or possibly Keacy Carty. And I said, however, you'll go and look at their numbers and you'll look at the numbers and go, no, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? And I said, but you have to trust me on this. Based on talent, it's going to have to be probably one of them two. Anyways, I think Joe must have looked at the numbers and not trusted me. but I'd love to know how Gravity Sports got to Alick, and what did you see? And I mean, the story writes itself based on what we're currently seeing now.
Yeah, so you've sort of inadvertently picked up one of my directors who works out of the Caribbean, North America. So when he listens back to this, I can tell you now I'm going to be getting a lot of stick off him. look, he's absolutely brilliant at what he does. You know, he works out of the West, out of the Caribbean. Like I say, he's one of our directors, and he's just got a brilliant handle on cricket, and he loves the game. You know, so for us, sometimes you look at a player's stats and you look at the journey, what they've been on. So with Alick, for example, you know, about a year ago when we took him on, his numbers weren't amazing. As you say, we knew that he had pedigree, being the top scorer in the under-19 World Cup, you know, ahead of Finn Allen and Shubman Gill. But it was a, sometimes you look at a player and think, you know what, they might just need a different environment or a different person working with them. And you take a little bit of a punt on them. And yeah, Alick's one of them players. And it could, to be honest with you, it could have been a number of players for us that did it. But Alick's gone on and just done incredibly over the last year. And it's a credit to him and his character. And I think if you go onto our website and have a look at our latest blog, which is a background into Alick and the journey he's been on as a hurricane survivor on his island, I think you'll see why he is the character he is, why he's the captain of Windward Islands as well, and genuinely why I believe he'll be someone who goes on and plays international cricket. And I think that if he was English or Australian, maybe Indian, he'd have probably already been playing international cricket by now. But I think guys in the Caribbean seem to take a little bit longer to come through for various reasons.
And then with someone like an Alick, and again, I know that you can't say too much, but I guess I want you to speak more hypothetically. So Alick could be anybody, but let's just say you have somebody like an Alick, and he's got the pedigree of the run scoring. So obviously Super 50, I think it was 200s in the Super 50. Obviously he's just ended top run scorer in the West Indies Championship by a long, long way. Captain the Windward Islands side, they didn't lose a game. Got called up to go and tour South Africa with the West Indies. Is yet to debut, but like I say, that probably is imminent.
Yeah.
Say you had someone in that vein of form. Now, yes, the runs write themselves, but in this present cricket market, how do you then get them further opportunities? And hear me out. Because I'm intrigued to know, do the runs just kind of write themselves and you don't need to do much more beyond that? And therefore people come to you. So clubs might come to you or whatever, or franchises or whatever it might be. Or do you have to push them? Not put them, by that I don't mean the player, I mean their stats or their kind of let's call it PR, the PR around them. Do you have to push it to respective clubs, pro, amateur, whatever it might be, and say, on that, this is a guy you should be thinking about? And I know I'm still going on a bit, but I'm trying to make sure I'm forensic in what I'm saying here. So let's say Alick will get called up for the India series if he's not injured, right? Let's say he gets called up for that. But after that test series is done, there's no guarantee he's in the ODI squad for West Indies or the T20 tour. And then there's a big gap of cricket between that period and let's say Christmas. There'll be Super 50 or something, but I mean like in terms of West Indies duty. So let's say you have a 3-month gap in his cricket calendar or a 2-month gap. Do you get where I'm coming from, Ethan? How do you fill it? Do you wait for people to come to you because they should, or do you still have to push him out there?
I think it depends on the player. I think for Alick specifically, it depends how he gets on properly in the West Indies series.
True. Good point.
I think that will make a big difference. It's very difficult to go to directors of cricket or club team owners, franchise owners, and say, this lad's really, really good, by the way. You should pick him. But if they've not heard of him, then they're unlikely to trust me. If I haven't got an explanation to them already, I suspect they'll have quite a few agents in their ear. So the way the industry works, certainly at the moment, and it's been like this for a little while, is that there will always be more. There'll always team owners and directors of cricket will always be more favourable towards players who perhaps are an ex-international or a name, because they've got a commercial side to that player as well. They can sell shirts or whatever it may be. There'll be more people watching through television than say picking up a relatively unknown player. Mm. So the way that players make their names nowadays is by getting themselves into the national sides and then performing on that stage to then fall into the T20 cricket or the individual, say, county teams or clubs around the world. But look, for sure, we want to try and make sure that guys haven't got gaps in their calendar. You know, if we can find something for Alick, who at that point, if he's gone on and performed well in the West Indies India series, then you know we're all for it. We always say we only try our best, but the players kind of write their own story. We're just there to put their name into conversations and making sure that when they do score those runs or take those wickets, that we are mentioning them to team owners, and they're not then picking someone else from a different side.
If we then use the example of Roshon then, so when Roshon came on our pod a couple of months back, he was in Australia, and I think he was playing for Deer Park, I think that was the name of the team he was playing for in Australia. So, and again, you can't give me too many details about certainly contracts and this, that, and the other, but how did you get him out to us? And in fairness, no, because Roshon told us that he had previously played in Australia. Yeah. But so does that mean it was just easier to put him back into the Australian market? Or was it more off the back of the fact that you had the 130 off 81 balls that he hit in Super 50 and that kind of innings getting a bit of global kind of, you know, clickbait around some like global feeds picked up on it? Was it easier off the back of that, or was it easier because he'd already been to Australia, so he was some people were aware of who Roshon was?
Yeah, I think a little bit of both. So because Roshon had been there before and he'd been with Deer Park before as well, he'd already got that link there. But it kind of leads on from what I was saying previously about they already knew who he was and they knew what he was about. So it was easy for them to go, okay, we want this person because we trust them. And it doesn't really matter whether that's an amateur team or it's, you know, an IPL team. If they know the player and they trust the player, they're more likely to have them back again. In terms of Roshon's 130 off 80 balls, I mean, firstly, I've not seen an innings like that in a while, or certainly in the Caribbean region. But he has had some interest off the back of that, for sure. And I think that he now needs to go and probably follow that up with another good score. You know, if you go and do that in the CPL, for example, that will put some real spotlights on him. And I think, hopefully, fingers crossed, he may get a West Indies call up. I don't know. Potentially, the next few months, we'll see. But you know, I think his career trajectory at the moment is certainly on the up for sure.
Mm. You've hinted at it. But for a sports agent or cricket agent, what are some of the barriers then you can face? And the reason why I say you've hinted at it, because I've picked up on the hint in terms of, well, and I say this with respect. So an owner, director of cricket, might look at you and say, well, but who are you to me in the context of whoever else? He may already have established relations. And I mean, I hope you get what I mean. He may already have established relationships with, I don't know, people who have been attached with the club for 10, 15 years. And that's just who they go to when it's time to kind of get players and so on and so forth. So from off the pitch, behind the boundary, so to speak, what are some of the barriers that there are that fans might not know about in terms of cricket agency and so on and so forth? And again, I guess I say that because a fan might look at a player and say, what is this player doing in their off season, as if they don't want to be doing something, as if they don't want to be doing something else, right? So, but like, I guess to help understand that, we have to understand what some of the barriers might actually be for players, and I guess by proxy, agents as well.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because there's certainly a lot more opportunities that are coming into the game now with all these franchise competitions popping up. But what we're seeing is the same players are moving around the same competitions, which means that it's tough for these guys to break through. It really is. And I think I think unless they break into a national side or they go and perform really well in a domestic T20 competition, say if you're already from the Caribbean and you go and play in the CPL, and perform well in that, I think there's a chance that then you go on and perhaps push your name into the reckoning with an IPL team or a PSL team. But it's very difficult for us, like I said earlier, to convince someone who doesn't know a player that this player is right for them. Because a lot of these teams now do their own research. There's a lot of analytics involved, or it's certainly coming in more than it perhaps was. And I think that going forward, if we as an agency make sure that we're, you know, partnering ourselves with the right players who've got the right work ethic and who want to push themselves, once they've then scored those runs, it's then easier to put their name into conversation. So that's probably one of the biggest barriers that we face day to day. I'm just trying to think if there's any others at the moment. I'll throw it back to you anyway.
Yeah, no worries. And I guess, has the, because you've spoken about obviously different leagues, particularly franchise leagues, opening up, how much of an impact has the growth of US minor league and I guess the US system in general? Because what I've noticed over the last, let's say even, it's probably longer, but I'm going to just say 2 years, certainly since we've come out of the other side of the pandemic, that more and more West Indian players are heading over to play minor league cricket. And to be fair, it's not just minor league cricket. It could be the Houston Open. It could be the Atlanta Open. It could be US Open. There's so many different US tournaments out there. Is that an example of how much? Because everyone thinks franchise means IPL, CPL, PSL, but there's actually so much. There's so many different formats of the franchise system to go and get involved in. And I just wonder if the minor league system has opened up just another area to help the players, you know, I guess for want of a better phrase, earn a living.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely. I think the money flowing into the US for cricket at the moment is significant. How it plays out, we'll see. I believe there's an ongoing dispute between US cricket and Major League at the moment. So it's going to be interesting to see how that unfolds. But no, there's certainly money earners there for players. If you can put names into conversations, again, there's so many teams out there now, so many that, you know, I could sit there all day talking to, you know, hundreds of teams because there's that many. So yeah, there's an opportunity for them to go and earn there for sure. Whether what we're seeing with some of these new T20 competitions is some are being administered quite well and some of them aren't, which produces its own challenges, especially for us as a business. You know, if you're trying to tell a player that they're flying out the next day or that afternoon or something like that because they just haven't sorted perhaps visas out properly or you know, the player's contract out yet. It can become really challenging. You know, it can certainly put stress on me and family if I'm on a call at 10, 11 o'clock because, you know, things are done at the last moment. Just to come back and say, yeah, I think, you know, there's certainly opportunity in the US, and I believe that as Indian cricket continues to take over the world as it is doing, there'll be more and more opportunities for players that aren't just Alex Hales and you know, Tom Curran and people like that who are going in and out of the same competitions all the time.
When you just mentioned there, obviously some leagues are better organized than others, it kind of just jogged my memory about something I wanted to ask you. So, and I should have asked you this at the top of the show, to be fair, how does an average week how does an average week look for you? Forget the players for a second. Is it a case that obviously a job is a job, right? And yeah, there's certain things that you know you have to do within any job. But some jobs, you're also kind of on heightened awareness that anything could happen at any particular moment in time. And I'm just intrigued with cricket agency that is it a structure where it's like basically every day there's certain kind of things I'm going to have to do, or is it more so because your roster is not just in one region or in one place, someone's always somewhere doing something? So is it in, do you see what I mean? So are you having to respond to different things at different times as a result?
There's absolutely no structure, honestly. I mean there are certain things we do, you know, there's certain like tasks that, you know, can become monotonous and you're doing over and over again, for sure. You know, some of the admin that we have to do, which, you know, is a requirement for us, but the in terms of opportunities and speaking with clubs, and honestly, it is just, it can be absolute chaos sometimes. I can wake up and have 10 messages on my phone and go to sleep and still be on my phone, honestly. And especially with the time zones, you know, I'm on calls. You know, a lot of our guys in the Caribbean, I'm on calls at 10, 11, 12 o'clock in the UK.
Yeah.
You know, trying to get things sorted. But, you know, equally, you know, we're having a chat with, say, someone in Bangladesh about sending a player over there. That can be early on in the morning. There's different ways of working as well, for sure. You know, if you get something done in the UK or in Australia, they have a very different way of working to, say, Bangladesh or Pakistan. But I think the for us, it makes it a lot easier when tournaments are administered properly. It makes our lives a lot easier. So, and it's something that, you know, it's something, and I've said this before publicly, that the ICC needs to get a handle on making sure that the competitions are administered and ran properly, because there's a lot of these competitions popping up now ran by some questionable characters that perhaps shouldn't really be in the game. But if they're approved by that national cricket board, then there's a limit to what the ICC can do sometimes.
Yeah, no, I hear that for certain. They need to introduce the fit and proper test that football has. And even then, people somehow still manage to pass it who shouldn't. But in terms of and actually, let's make this a more general question and interpret it how you want. In terms of the West Indies as a region, I'd certainly say that there's huge untapped potential there. I recently saw that you'd signed Darren Ned, which is interesting to me, because certainly for a lot of our listeners, unless they're based in Grenada, or unless they're really deep in West Indies or Caribbean cricket, they wouldn't necessarily know who Darren Ned is. But he's certainly a super talented player with huge potential. He would have been part of the Grenada side that came here last summer on tour. So, and I don't know, maybe some of our listeners went out to watch some of those matches that they did on tour, et cetera, et cetera. And the reason why I use Darren as an example is, for those who don't know him, it just highlights how much of the region, there's so much untapped potential in the Caribbean. And the question I ask you off the back of that is, because I'm sure you're going to agree and say, yeah, there's huge untapped potential. And I still don't think people have fully got to grips with just how much talent there is within the region. We all talk about it superficially, and you'll hear it on commentary streams and this, that, and the other. But when you siphon off the top level of players that people see, there is huge talent in the region. You hinted at it earlier on. Because of our development structures, sometimes it just takes them longer to get to that end goal than they probably would do in a quote-unquote better system, to speak, right? But given how much cricket is changing, the industry certainly looks nothing like what it did 5 years ago. And I don't know how you even approach answering this question. How do you square it? How does a region like the Caribbean, with all of their talent, then adapt to this change in industry where, okay, so take Test cricket, there's not much of it going on for teams like the West Indies. So if you're a young player, you're not necessarily going to make it to Test level quickly, because there's just not enough of it even to play, really and truly, for the West Indies. Maybe some of the white ball stuff, and obviously all the franchise tournaments. So it's a massive question there, Ethan. I don't know how you're going to approach it, but how do you adapt to the change in market? And is it almost harder to pick up a young player and help them kind of traverse this ever-changing market? Because it's not as simple as perform for your regional side like Alick has done, get into the Indies side, get your global name out there. It's not that straightforward, not as straightforward anymore.
No. I don't really know where to start on this. I'll start where you started with Darren, who, bless him, did really, really well in the UK last year, really well. I don't know, for those that don't know, he came over with a touring side from Grenada. If you haven't seen the clips, go on our website and have a look. There's some clips on there. There is a six, and I've never heard a sound off a bat like it in my life. It is unbelievable, and I've never seen a reaction from a bowler or a keeper like it in my life. They are just astonished with how far he's hit this ball. And he did really well in a regional T10 at the start of the year as well, playing with Alick. So, look, Darren's got a big future. I think I think you came on to opportunities next. So I think with opportunities in the region, look, we've got a really good relationship with Cricket West Indies. I do honestly really think they need a domestic T20 competition as well. Yeah. I think if you look at most of the major nations around the world now, UK, India, Australia, they've all got domestic T20 competitions as well. And what's happening is that a lot of the teams for the CPL are now having to pick out of guys who have performed well in the Super 50.
Yeah.
Whereas really they should be having to pick out of guys that perform well in a regional T20 competition.
Yeah.
So I think there's not as great an opportunity there for some of the younger guys coming through in the region, because there's not the regular games for them to go in and do that. Finally, what was the final part of the question, Michelle?
Yeah, no, you almost nearly hit it there, because I guess the final part was, with the game changing so much. So, for example, West Indies playing six test matches a year. So, for Alick, who is very much suited to the long format, there's a clear path. Do you see what I mean? There's a clear pathway where, even with our limited test matches, he's gonna get some West Indies recognition. But say you're a short format, as I think, and that's why I think you've pretty much hit the nail on the head. Like, how do you for a sports agent, like I say, I talk specifically with the Caribbean, because it's not as structured within the Caribbean region.
I was going to say, I actually think by default some of these US T20 competitions are becoming like the West Indies regional competition. A lot of guys are getting flown out from the UK and Scotland, wherever else, to come and play in the competition or in these competitions. But I think, we worked with Anthony Bramble as well, who had a really good minor league last year for the New Jersey Stallions. And I think that certainly helped his four-day and credentials this year for Guyana. So, it'd be interesting to see which way the West Indies go with it, the West Indies Cricket Board go with it over the next couple of years. Hopefully they can keep a handle on keeping guys in the region, because that's what we want to see, not just going out and playing in the US. These younger guys like Darren and can showcase their skills in a regional competition.
Well, I feel like, Ethan, I've mentioned some names earlier on. So anybody who's watching this, last week I did a interview with Dariel Bartley, who runs the Antigua Cool and Smooth, which will be starting next week on the 13th of April. And Dariel and I spoke a bit about Kofi James and how, if any cricket person had any sense, they'd be all over Kofi James right now in terms of... So anyone who's watching this, I'm officially telling you, Kofi James is a seriously talented cricketer. And if you are somebody who's wondering, who's coming out of the region who I should invest in, Kofi's one of them, for example. So here's me and Ethan telling you, Kofi James is somebody you should probably try and go and have a look at, right? But because I don't know, we never know who watches these episodes. Every time somebody messages us and says, I watched the episode, we're like, how did it get to your ears? So I don't know who's going to watch this, Ethan. But what I do know is, say somebody watches this who is either, I don't know, director of some cricket club or whatever it might be, or a player or whatever it might be. And they're like, I need to speak to these people at Gravity Sports. Well, what's the best way forward then? If you're not approaching them, what would you advise them to do if they've come out of this and they're like, I'd love to speak to them and have some more conversations about whatever they want to have a conversation about?
Yeah, find us on Instagram. We do a lot of our socials through that. You can drop us a DM or www.gravity-sports.uk. So that's our website. Again, you can just fill in the contact form on there. You've got my number, Mash. If there's anyone really important, please chat with me. I'm sure you'll learn.
I am a conduit, people. Come to me as well.
So, yeah. And then just touching on Kofi, what you said before, he's a great character as well. Yeah, and I don't think people realise that, having known him personally, he's a really good character and a very talented cricketer. So, and I think what I liked about, and I don't know if you follow Kofi's journey through the four-day comps, but started batting at four, I believe.
Yeah.
And was down at eight by the end of it because he hadn't scored. And then all of a sudden scored 100. So that's just, it's a testament of his character that he's able to go, you know what, I don't care that I'm getting dropped down the order. I'm going to fight and score some runs anyway. And then on the flip side of that, I think he was second or third top wicket taker in the Super 50.
Yeah, exactly.
So, you know, bat and ball, what more do you want? Like you said before, there's so many talented guys. Anaji Amori is one to watch out for as well. St. Kitts and Nevis, he's taking an awful, awful lot of wickets at like youth team under 19 level. He had the best economy of any bowler in the under 19 World Cup last year. I'm surprised he's not already playing professionally, I'll be honest with you. But as we've said before, it takes a little bit of time sometimes for these lads to come through or being given an opportunity. But he's another one who I'd certainly watch out for.
Well, it's definitely, I feel I'm assuming and hoping that in the upcoming Headley Weeks Tri Series that he'll be part of the West Indies Academy side that's partaking in that. And just briefly before we wrap this one, just off the back of what Ethan was saying, Ree Kofi, in case there's anybody listening to this from CPL, Kofi, and people must be listening to this going, what are you just, am I Kofi's agent? No. but I am saying that Kofi is probably a perfect example of the type of player who, because we don't have a regional T20, I'm fairly certain he's going to go and play in the Cool and Smooth. If he's not selected in one of the Team Headley or Team Week series, he'll play in the Cool and Smooth tournament in Antigua. And the hope would be that CPL franchises, and not just the St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots, would look at a tournament like that and say, let's not use Super 50. Let's actually look at some of these T20 and T10 tournaments that have been happening throughout the year. And that's where you pick up your kind of next generation of talent that you take a punt on. So there's my advice, people. Go have a look at things like Cool and Smooth over the next 2 weeks, and you'll see players like Kofi James playing. And then you might know why Ethan and I are talking so highly about him. But listen, Ethan, I don't even feel like, I feel like we've only just got into it, you know. But what I want to do is, let's call that part one. Let's call that one part one, because what's going to happen is, I think people are going to watch this one, they're going to come back to you with all these different types of questions, then they're going to have to hit you up again and say, listen, we need to go to part two off the back of it. But I'm going to call that one part one, Ethan.
Absolutely, yeah. You know, drop some comments in, you know, on whatever social media that you post it onto, and I'm more than happy to come back on and answer any questions.
Absolutely brilliant, ladies and gentlemen. So that's been Ethan Brookes from Gravity Sports. Like I say, look in the descriptors below, whether on audio platforms or whether you're watching this on YouTube, whatever it might be, go and click the link, go and read about them, go and look at their roster, and if you're a club owner, whatever it might be, director of cricket or a player, go get involved. Go and have those conversations, people. And this is why we wanted to have this chat, not just to understand sports management and cricket agency, but to also allow people within the region, fans of West Indies cricket, to understand that there are organisations already working with some of our cricketers within the region and trying to uplift them. Ethan, I'm going to leave you to have the final words.
No, yeah, thanks very much for having me on. Hopefully, Santoki will be on next time I join you. But no, it's been great to have a chat with you, Michelle. You know, I think there's not enough of this that goes on in the industry. I'm always someone who says, you know what, why not? You know, why not come on and have a chat about things? And it's an excuse as well to make people aware of some of our really talented guys as well. I really, really appreciate it. And like I say, look forward to catching up with you again sometime soon.
Absolutely brilliant. Ladies and gentlemen, that's been Eathan Brookes from Gravity Sports Agency. I've been Mashel St. Patrick Hewitt, one half of the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. As ever, like, share, rate, review, subscribe, etc. Get at us in the comments below. Anything you wanted to know about that episode, at us at Twitter or Instagram at Carib Cricket. You can find us on Facebook as well, Caribbean Cricket Podcast. The website is www.caribbeancricketpodcast.com. Anything you want to know, just let me know, people. And if anything, I can pass it on to Eathan. But thank you for listening as ever. Thank you and good night. We rule the cricket world. Now the Welcome to the Caribbean Cricket Podcast, your one-stop shop for all things West Indies cricket, by the fans, for the fans.